Bonjour à tous. Ça va bien? J'ai une mauvaise nouvelle pour vous, je vais parler en français. Pourquoi? Parce que nous sommes dans la semaine de la langue française et de la francophonie. Voilà. Qui comprend le français? Qui understand French? Okay. So all the other ones grew around them. Right? But more seriously, it's to tell them that I come from a province of Quebec in Canada where we speak a different language. And I think that will probably help you understand the connection that we may have where I come from and where you're coming from in the world. Let me start to say that I'm very excited to be here. This is my first world tour of Baltic states. I have arrived on Saturday in Tallinn, spent 2 days there, was in Riga 2 days, and now Vilnius 2 days. I feel like a rock star. They take you from one audience to the next. It also feels like speed dating. You know, we say hello, we make love, we say goodbye, we hope the phone is going to ring. Papa, you forget me in Vilnius. Oh, la, la. So, thank you to the Canadian Embassy, their colleagues here, because they made this happen. And I want you to applaud this woman in front. Mirta, she was the one that made me this connection. That's very important. We've been exchanging emails. I have tons of emails. So let me get to my notes. I want to react and give you some feedback on what I just heard. I just want to tell you also that you have a fabulous ambassador to UNESCO, Arunash Agelunash, who is like also a rock star. He is really involved in this UNESCO convention personally and on behalf of Lithuania. He's been moderating our meetings of the Intergovernmental Committee very smoothly, very efficiently. The world is moving with him. We are advancing on these conversations and we're making great progress. I really want to salute him personally. I know he was a former minister and an artist himself, so you have really a great ambassador. I also want to say that Lithuania is up there with the best. I was recently a UNESCO expert in Indonesia. We had a program, and I'll refer to that in my presentation. We're assisting Indonesia with preparing its own report on what has been done for the convention in the last 4 years and what will be done in the next 4 years. And when I'm trying to be practical so the Indonesians see what it looks like, I use Lithuanian periodic report, the first one that was presented. It's clear, it's got very relevant examples, and it's got results, not just statements. We see the numbers, how much money, who was the target audience, and when possible, we see if anything was achieved. And that is exemplary, because in a lot of these reports, very good statements, no problem. But of course, we know it's not the problem. The problem's implementation. So you have nothing to be afraid of. You're probably just on the verge of doing more and being even better and being even more proactive in culture in Europe and in the diversity of cultural expressions. That's how I sort of see Lithuania from the outside. This week, just to give you some sense of some of the issues in the Baltic states, because this is going to be about the Convention on Sustainable Development. This is probably the first of the presentations that I've been giving or attending this week on the issue. We first discussed cultural policies in Estonia. Do we have cultural policies? What are they addressing? Well, again, what are the needs? Do we have enough for the artists? Do we have status for the artists? Do we have an arts council? Do we have scholarship grants for the artists? Cultural industries, and so on and so forth. We then discussed indicators. In Latvia, they're having a hard time to convince the finance ministry to support the arts and culture. The finance ministry is looking to release funds to create jobs, regional development, businesses. And so they're looking to the high cost of art schools, vocational schools, infrastructure, programming in the arts across the country, and saying that's a lost money for government. It's a cost. We don't see the benefit. Prove us there is a benefit. That is the issue for Latvia. And of course, they have pretty strong economic indicators, possibly that can be strengthened, but they're also looking for social indicators. And we show that being educated of the arts and culture, being active in creative communities, will bring better civic duties, better citizens that are educated to be active, responsible, and possibly creative to become themselves agent of social change or agent of entrepreneurial economic change as a result of their creative, artistic education. So those are some of the kind of challenges. And coming to this country, and this was also addressed in Estonia, immigrants, immigration. What is diversity? What are the rules of engagement and living together? Vivre ensemble, living together. How do we define that for the next wave of European, or possibly Middle Eastern immigrants? And that's obviously very, very timely. Not an easy subject, I will give you that. And I have to say to our friends in Lithuania, if you do reinvent yourself, and if you do succeed in becoming this creative people and creative economy that obviously you're seeking to be, you might just end up like Ireland. When I was a student 30 years ago, Ireland was bleeding, literally bleeding talent and youth to Europe. And today, it is attracting a destination of choice. So for them, immigration and creativity has been really, I'm sure, a core concern. And we can think of South Korea, which was bleeding after the war, is now also questioning itself on immigration and so on and so forth. So some of the issues in the region. Let me also respond to some of the things I've heard on the panel, and you'll say I have strong personal connections to a lot of what was said. First on handicap. My eldest son is handicapped. He's got cerebral palsy, so he's a bit like this. And he has, you know, a four-way to speak. But it just happens to be that he came to the world in an era where it's possible to be an artist and a handicapped person. When I was young, there was only one career, hockey player. All parents were hoping for their kids, and they would put tons of money and bring them to the arena. Fortunately, policies and creative industries were so structured and successful that we eventually had a business for stand-up comedians, people that are actually, I call them oral tradition in the modern way. They come and they tell you stories, and they're really culturally, you know, very heavy in meaning, because humor is connected to perceptions and identity. They are rock stars, truly, in my hometown, in my home province. They are millionaires. They make good money, and they are on TV. And so when he was 10 with me, he saw and he said, that's what I want to do. He took lessons, he was on stage, he became an actor, he was on national TV, playing the handicap, he was in a short movie playing the handicap. He's inspiring and he's inspired. Now, what's the outcome? The question was asked, what's the outcome? Well, the outcome for him is self-esteem, of course. He's a role model, a handicapped role model, not only for handicapped, but for youth more generally. And he's basically in a process which enlightens him. He's empowered now to take ownership of his life, and culture has made that possible. So I think that's the main message here, is that culture, we have education systems, and we have norms, and we want to achieve you know, things for our kids so they're grown-ups and responsible adults. But culture is the lifelong learning. It's the informal learning, and it's the connection to ourselves and to the community. So I think that's really, in my sense, a lesson to be learned from my son. On the graphic design, my daughter wants to be a graphic designer. So she's going to Italy next week to be next to Milano to experience some of that. And I would agree with some of the projects that are being, you know, offered, basically take ownership and again, be self-empowered to express your identity. Be given the tools, basically, simple tools, but tools to experiment with those self-expressions. The question was asked, graffiti. There's graffiti because we have drug dealers. They want to mark their territory. But there's graffiti because there's also frustration and a need to express. So can we channel that energy in a positive way is probably one of the questions, especially in countries, and I speak to myself, where you have official art, you have official speech, you have official places for culture to be expressed, and then suddenly people feel, yeah, but I want to be part of the dialogue. I want also to participate in this, and they have not structured themselves yet, so they are graffitiing. For them, it's the way to show that they have a voice. Well, that's probably a good sign. It's a negative sign, but it's a good sign because this city, this country is showing that, yes, the arts is something that we support. On the creative spaces and all these experiments with and the sustainability issues that they raise, Vancouver, the city of Vancouver has a policy of culture, and they're trying to map. They're trying exactly to do what you're doing because they're saying what is below the surface is probably more important than what's above the surface. It will give them a measure of the creativity and the creative hubs. They call them creative hubs and creative spaces. And that's very, to me, very important because these creative spaces are actually the positive spaces for experimentation, connection, and again, community through a sense of belonging. People are looking and we are in need of positive social norms. And that's, for a lot of us, that's what's missing. When we're young, are the parents in agreement that we can do, you know, I'm a boy, I'm going to do ballet, papa. He's going to look at you and say, can you not think of engineering or theater science, please? You know, or if you're in a small town and you think of putting up something on the street, they're going to look at you and say, this is for the museums or this is for the concert hall. You don't put this on the street, I'm sorry. So those moments of positive reinforcements are the creative spaces. The safe havens, the place where you need security, not only to start connecting with people, but also connecting with issues that might be challenging. Because you might want to be addressing, you know, I say this all the time, LGBT issues, minority, marginalized issues, immigrants issues, challenging political issues. That's the power of art. That's the power of culture. If you don't have safe space to do that, if you don't have positive social norms to do that, you're at risk. You do this at your own risk. How many of us would do that at your own risk? So these creative spaces are very, very important, in my view, to get us a sense. They're a strong indicator something happening, and then something happening beyond body counts. You know, it's not just the number of visitors, because that's outcomes. We have one show, so many dollars, so many people, that's easy. But what's the long-term outcome? What is changing? What is sustainable as a result of what was proposed? Well, if people take ownership, we could have creative spaces, informal creative spaces, something is happening. We have outcomes. And finally, on these connections with schools and these partnerships and so on, you will actually see in my presentation some of similar examples. I think it has to do with role models, very strong role models for kids and experimenting with different art forms. But it also has to do with something we call cultural mediation. And most are probably familiar with this. If not, I invite you to look. Franz has good programs. We have them too in Canada. What is a cultural mediator? It's someone who can be trained. An artist can become a cultural mediator, a professor, a teacher can become a cultural mediator, a social worker can become one as well. They are trained and learn how to actually bridge the gap between art forms, challenging art forms, and communities for audiences, introducing one to another. So bringing contemporary dance to a small remote village that's never had a chance to see contemporary dance, and who might not be able to appreciate contemporary dance unless it's introduced to the code, the aesthetics. You know, these are new people dancing to rhythmic music, and what's the meaning of this? So that's the mediator's job, to do something like this. And to give you an example of what I'm trying to say, I was in a meeting in Mexico City. The fellow beside me, who became himself a cultural administrator, had worked with his mother. She was a ballet dancer, had lived all her life in a small pueblo, a small village, and had 300 choreographies of classical music that she shared and educated the pueblo people to learn and practice. And when he heard me say the word cultural mediation, it went like, that's what she's been doing all her life. It struck him. He had been assisting his mother to introduce an art form that's totally foreign to these people. So I think that's also something that we may want to sort of strengthen, as not to leave people just to themselves, but actually be ambassadors and connectors. Because when we do that, we also allow some of the difficult issues, some of the challenges that these kids, that these young people, that these communities, the art becomes the connection, the dialogue that we can have on some of these difficult and personal issues. That's the power of arts and culture, the transformative power of arts and culture. So just some feedback, just to say I've enjoyed the presentations this morning. And thank you for that. So let me go to my PowerPoint. Yeah, let's do that. So far, so good?
Yes. Ça se passe bien en français aussi? Tout va bien?
Tout va bien.
Tout va bien.
So, that's the other one. Well, I'll start with this and I'll switch back to the real presentation. This is just some intro. I want to... The reasons why we have the instrument of UNESCO, you know, the diversity of cultural expression, that instrument. There are seven conventions of UNESCO. The most important ones, if you're familiar, have to do with heritage. Tangible buildings, stones, things from the past that are set in time that we want to preserve. Old towns. The other one, which is also very active at UNESCO in 2003, is about immaterial, intangible expressions, oral traditions, weaving, cooking, and there's a list now of these world treasures of intangible heritage that we want to preserve. This is, I think, the issue at stake. These are civilizations. We now know that we have more than 7,000 languages. We now see that Europe has already completely, if not completely, integrated its languages and possibly its cultures as it has become closer and closer. We now know that of these languages, 12 of them actually capture 75% of the world population. But as a result, and you have them in proportion to the Chinese and the Arabic and so on and so forth. No surprise there. The red dots are at risk. They possibly will be gone by the end of the century. Seriously endangered and endangered. And you can see where that's happening. Why is that? En français. 96% of those 7,000 languages are spoken just by 3% of the world population. 2,000 of these languages have less than 1,000 speakers, sometimes 80,
times times two. And so half of those languages, half will be gone by the end of the century. We'll have lost 3,500 languages. And we know we're not losing languages, we're losing civilizations. We're losing the diversity that we're trying to protect and promote. These perceptions, these visions of the world that are actually our common treasure, our common heritage. So I think that's really what's at stake. Even though the convention is not about languages or civilizations or traditional knowledge or just Aboriginal groups, this is a convention about cultural products and services and industries. But to give voice through a book to a group, to a language, to a minority expression, to a marginalized person is actually to protect, to promote that language, that identity, that vision of the world. Can you help me just switch back? I just wanted to give you, we'll come back to this presentation. Then we go back to the other one. Oh, I just go kick. Sorry for the So just on the reason why, and let me sort of briefly maybe explain who I represent. I think it's important to understand who I represent. I represent civil society movement, artists, cultural professionals, who in the years of the 1990s, for those that remember, it was a big discussion and it was in the news every night, trade globalization, trade liberalization. We were in Seattle, we were in Quebec City, and the civil society was opposing this push to make everything global by big companies and the stronger countries. And the artists were there to receive the water and the pepper spray in the face because they say, culture is not like everything else. It's not cars. It's not lumber. It's not meat. It's not bread. It's about language. It's about identity. Of course, it's economic, but it's also social and cultural. And so we made the argument and we tried to convince the negotiators that this had to be treated differently. There should be an exception, a treatment special for culture and cultural products and services. They would not listen to it. So my members are painters, they are photographers, they are cinema producers, writers of books, publishers, and so on. I represent in Canada 200,000 workers in the cultural sector and more than 1,000 businesses in the cultural sector. Why we mobilized? Canada has very strong policies to support and fund the artists in the cultural sector. My francophone friends in the Quebec province, we are six million francophones in a country of 36, so we're one in six. We're a small minority. But if you include the United States, 360 million English-speaking, very strong culture, Hollywood, we are just 6 million and almost 400 million. That's like 3 million Lithuanian in Europe. You're small and we're small and we have a language that no one else speaks on our side of the ocean. If we're not careful, our voices will not be heard. Our language will not be spoken. Our kids will listen to Lady Gaga and will learn the words of her songs. And they do. So very early on, since 1960, we create ministry, we create policies, we support, we have schools to train our people to be cultural managers, and we have the result. The result is on the screen. We now have GDP contribution, which is
You see the numbers.
4%. No politician can say this is not important. Jobs. No one can say this is not important. And of course, we have indirect contribution because the book that you write becomes the story of a film. The story of the film becomes a television series. The television series may lead to a video game. The video game inspired the architect and the designer. So it's a ripple effect that starts from the simple act of writing, of expressing orally, of performing on stage. That very simple act of creation is a chain of event that we call the creative economy. So there's direct benefit, but there's plenty of indirect economic benefit as well. We have creative people in a creative society. And we're able to say that almost 1 in 10, 90%, possibly not, but 1 in 10 household actually directly or indirectly living, making an income out of this creative industries. No wonder Canada. I'll leave you with a PowerPoint if you're on the PowerPoint. Look at what the consumers, this is you and me paying for a ticket, buying a record. This is what we put out of pocket. Well, we put 3 times what government had to invest to start the cultural economy. They have to put collectively 7 billion. This was 2007. I'm sure we have more recent statistics. But if we add what the national, the regional, and the local governments have invested to support these infrastructure or the artists themselves, we have now 3 times more private sector consumer money coming to feed. So we have diversified. And we can tell the politicians this is more important than very sort of strategic industries, furniture, appliances, more than sports events. What a surprise. We spend more, so my father would be proud. I did not take hockey into culture. And we still have challenges. It's not to say everything's rosy, everything's fine. We have 90% concentrated just close to the United States. If you look at the map, it's just very, very close. Which means we're exposed. So truly, there's a lot of American and international cultural products being consumed and watched and listened to. It's not all Canadian products that we listen to and watch and appreciate. And we have a lot of rural communities. So a concern for our cultural policies is access and participation for everyone. That culture pour tous, culture for all. That's one of our main themes of cultural policy. The United States is our main trading partner. I will not say it is not important strategically, politically, and culturally. And we have everything coming in. Now, to give you again an example, I've given you the sort of financial benefit, but because culture has this dual nature of being cultural and economic, if you succeed the economic side and you do it well, possibly you will succeed the cultural side as well. Both at the same time, not just one without the other. In the French province, in the Quebec province, and this is another presentation on book publishing. When we started the ministry in 1960, the books were sold by French bookshops, French publishers. There was little reading in our own literature. Very few publishers. The government thought of a way to strengthen and change the value chain, to change the way the industry is structured. They said that's the weakest link. They said, let's start there. What they did is to nationalize. They said you cannot operate unless you're a national. They created a postal system. If you are recognized as a bookshop selling books, you will have to have 30% almost a third of her books from the province. In return of that obligation, all purchases made by libraries, local authorities, schools will be to you. You will have revenues, but you will have obligations. We will return the books. They have then evolved to change the distributor role. They have structured and reinforced all of the elements of the value chain over the years. Well, now we have moved from 120 publishing houses to 300 publishing houses. We have moved from 30% of books sold to 50% of books sold. We have estimated 1,000 professional authors who make a living and who can report that their main income is writing books. We have 6,000 titles published every year, original titles, 25,000 when we include what's coming from France and abroad. Revenues have tripled, three times revenues have tripled over this period of time for the publishers, and we export. And again, to be very practical, one of our young authors, Kim Thuy, she's Vietnamese, Canadian, she speaks French like I speak French, she was born in Canada from Vietnamese parents. She's a rock star for my children. They look to her because her literature is brilliant. Well, in Estonia, at the university, her book was shown to me in Estonian language. That is book publishing through cultural policies for culture and economic benefits. So you can imagine that when these negotiations were starting, we said, well, it's fine for UNESCO to have discussion on heritage, but what about contemporary culture? What about what makes us come alive and connect and be communities? And so someone said, maybe we have trade negotiations, maybe let's have a cultural negotiation. Maybe let's have a text that says culture is not like everything else. And this was the idea, this was the notion that got everyone excited. Of course, Canada was there, France was there, Quebec was there, and now we have a movement of these civil society organizations in 40 countries. And they have all encouraged their governments to sign on, to support it, to sign on. And when this was voted in Paris, we had majority, large majority of countries to say yes. We have one saying no. Guess who? Can anyone say who did not approve of this convention? You must have some idea, please. You, sir, you seem to know. Who said no? What country said no to the convention?
Say the first letter.
Which?
The first letter. Tell us.
You.
USA.
USA and Israel. They were the only two ones that opposed. And there were a number of countries that did not vote yes, they abstained, but there has been change of government in these countries, and since they have voted yes. And now we are counting 142 countries that have said yes, we want to ratify. And we have all countries of Europe, and we have the European Union as a separate entity. So 28 plus, the European Union also has ratified. So this is truly now a universal instrument. And we're moving, this is just to show you some of the benefits of this cultural policy. I'm sure you'll recognize some of those names. You probably listen to them at home yourself, right? Céline Dion, Alanis Morissette, Shania Twain, let me read, Michael Bublé, ladies, Diana Krall, jazz, Justin Bieber for the young ones. These are all Canadians. All Canadians. And you know why they become who they are now? Because part of the policy in Canada is also what we call a quota system. As a radio, as a television, as your license, you receive a license to operate a private or a public service. you have a duty because this is public service, right? This is airways. Well, just like in France and other countries as well, there should be a percentage of what you present every day or during the day that will be for local artists. The policy is not to close the border. The policy is not to protect by refusing the American products or the European products. The policy is to give voice, to support, to create and create space for these products and services to be heard and seen. So the quota is just like for the books. You will have benefit, but you have an obligation. So if Alanis Morissette, if Shania Twain are heard and played on the radio domestically while they are bought, they are going to be performed. Eventually with them, the industry is going to structure itself because she will need lighting, she will need sound, she will need stage, she will need touring managers, she will need producers. So you're building the quality professional infrastructure, and when we're ready to export, then we're not only exporting the names, we're exporting all of the industry that goes behind it. And it's the same for the film. I'm sure the film industry is trying to raise the level of its technical expertise so they can tell the British or the Americans or the Japanese, come and shoot a film in Lithuania, we have excellent technical expertise. They might even give them fiscal incentive, you know, a reduced rate on the cost of manpower if you employ local technicians, but these have to be world-class technicians. So by developing these artists, we develop the industry, the ripple effect, the economic benefit. And of course, as Canadians see these national artists on the world stage, it's role modeling, quite good. Positive reinforcement, positive social norms. Can any politician say it's not good for the people? That would be very difficult to say it's not good for the people to put money in this. I'm repeating things that I've already said. The World Trade Organization, we tried, and this is not me, this is way before me, but Europe, France, Canada, and others tried to convince the people who wanted more globalization to recognize the audiovisual exception. They refused. So we went to UNESCO, and this is opposing competition. We have a convention that speaks to cooperation. We are not removing trade barriers. There is a commitment in the UNESCO Convention to offer better treatment, special treatment for artists and products coming from developing countries. We should make a special effort to allow them to come to our markets so we have fairer trade, we have better trade, better exchange of our diversity of cultural expressions through these products and services. Speaks to the mobility of artists. We should facilitate visa entry for these artists from developing countries, touring arrangements, residencies, scholarships. So that's preferential treatment. And instead of being brought to court, which happens to be if you're in a trade agreement, there will be soft mediation to try and resolve our differences. And of course, we speak to the diversity in trying to protect that diversity. So the convention speaks to the dual nature. It's a counterweight. It's not on top of it or it's not below it. It's equal. In law, all of these agreements have equal weight. So should there be a dispute, should someone have to interpret the value of the convention, it will be equally to try and understand how each influences the other one. It's the first of its kind, of course. And I think it's shared challenges. Truly, if countries have been so eager to see this come to life, they face the challenge of diversity. They face the challenge of immigration. They face the challenge of multinationals, of the internet, of Netflix. All of these challenges are actually shared challenges. And when we go to UNESCO, that's the kind of conversation we're trying to have. We're trying to share best practices, to learn from one another, and eventually to find solutions that will address these challenges. That's the cooperation that we get from this convention. It's legally binding. and its policies. It's really about policies. And I want to maybe give you a sense of my definition of policy. Policy, we have this conversation. What is policy? Well, it's strategy, and it's, you know, it's rules, and it's... I define policy as the vision of the future. We're trying to make decisions today for tomorrow. We're trying to build the roads for the cars of tomorrow. Will it be one lane? Will it be two lanes? Will it be electric cars? Will they have drivers? We need to start building today because we need the road tomorrow. Well, it's the same thing for any policy. We're trying to create the educational system today for the kids of tomorrow and the society we want tomorrow. So the cultural policy is the same. We're trying to create the best environment for the creative voices, for the diversity of expressions to circulate on that road. And so we need to collectively come together what the world would look like, not design the car. It's not for us to design the car. We want the artists to design the car. We want the people to share their expressions, the cultural industry, to make a business with it. But we need to imagine the future now. It is not a convention on ethnic and linguistic diversity. There's a lot of confusion. People think, oh, we're going to protect languages, traditional knowledge, Aboriginal people, and so on. It is not, as I just said, an obligation that subordinates, and it is not a barrier to circulation. The Chinese have tried that. The Chinese took the Americans took the Chinese to court before an international trade tribunal. And in China, there's a quota on film from foreign films. 30 films a year. It's not a lot. Growing economy, middle class. It's the booming market for films today. It's on top of the United States in terms of revenue growth, on top of Japan. Everyone's fighting to be in China. Think of Panda 1, 2, 3, you know, the animation movie. So the Americans took the Chinese to court and say, that is trade restriction and flow of cultural goods and services. The Chinese said, yeah, but we are protecting and promoting our diversity of cultural expression. No, not an argument. Because protecting is safeguarding, not protecting the quotas. So they lost the argument. Now the quota has gone up to 60 films. It's not quite open, but it's happening. Slowly. And the Chinese and the American are in bed. The Chinese have bought some of the cinema chains in the United States. The Americans are making movies for China, and they're in bed trying to co-finance and co-produce. So it's happening. Some of those responses, some of those challenges, social inclusion, no surprise to all of you. I mean, we've heard some of that this morning. Sustainable development, taking into account culture and creativity. And I'll give examples, we'll come to that later. Share cultural experience, national building, nation building, social norms, positive reinforcement, the minority voices, minority expressions, the right to express itself, and I've added, because that's the big theme now in UNESCO, is the digital era, the digital challenge for cultural policies, sovereignty in applying and defining policies and having the laws and enforcing those laws is really becoming a big, big issue. As companies such as iTunes, Netflix, YouTube, and so on, not only are, you know, broadcasting these contents and taking the money and the viewers sucking everything away, but even being smart enough to position themselves in countries where there's no tax to pay. So now they're going to Ireland, and they're going to Holland, and Luxembourg, and the Virgin Islands, and then to, you know, what's called fiscal optimization or evasion. Should they be paying taxes? At least maybe if they have our viewers and they don't show our contents, at least we could get them, you know, tax a little bit of their economic activity. But we can't even do that. So right now, governments are considering to have a tax specifically imposed on the activities of those internet content providers. Is that legally okay? Is that okay with European Union law? Is that okay with trade?
Those are the kinds of discussion and the kinds of solution and challenge that we're facing collectively. Some will say it's the 2.0 version of the diversity of cultural expression. We had, you know, Hollywood in the first phase and World Trade Organization in the first phase. This is the second phase of the battle. These multinationals are truly cultural companies and cultural content providers, very, very successful. Key concept, this is from UNESCO. So diversity in creativity and innovation. We always get these notions because the convention is so broad and a happy convention that everyone wants to join the fiesta, the party. So traditional dance is a form of cultural expression. Sorry, that would be heritage. Because you're trying to safeguard and protect in the traditional sense forever after. If you have this traditional dance with modern music, instruments, if you have a way to connect the modern with the old, then we'll consider that contemporary expressions. You're reinventing, you're creating, you're making it relevant to the people and to the future of the identity. If you want to discuss protecting and setting in stone and preserving, there are other conventions for that. Is diverse form of artistic creation. There's also this question. What's the list of acceptable artistic expression? There is no list in the convention. It doesn't say sound, images, or it doesn't say music and dance and theater and so on. And it's a good thing it hasn't. Because, I'm gonna go there. Should they have listed things 10 years ago, or 15 years ago when they started, they might have missed on the bottom right of your screen. Street art, graffiti art, circus art. New forms of expression that are relevant to the younger generation. Spontaneous forms of expression, street forms of expression, that are now being recognized and funded and have programs to support the best artists. So the list is not a closed one. Let's keep that in mind. But it's one because I was asked, well, a chair is a cultural expression. A building is a cultural expression. The message. These cultural industries and these artistic expressions are not about the economy. You're not buying the book. You're buying the story. You're buying the connection between you and that story, and you and that story, and the author of that story, and all the readers of that story. That's what matters. It's the message in the middle, not the support. The rest is to organize and structure for these messages to circulate, and as many messages to be in the middle. If you're successful in building the economy of your cultural industries, you will have a diversity of messages. And that's what's important. Am I going too fast, Ms. Gomez? Is this okay?
It's fast. You speed up.
I am just speed up.
I'm not very good at speeding up.
I'm no longer young, I'm sorry.
So some of the concepts that I think are useful, because there was some of that this morning, the healing power, these are conceptual notions, and I'm referring you to some of the authors, so you might want to read further. The healing power of culture, South Africa is using this, Indonesia speaking about this, in era in regions where there has been civil war or apartheid, but we can think also of war zones in the cities. We've heard of neighborhoods that are literally war zones in the cities, or of using the power of art to address difficult, challenging questions. We put art through the power of mediation to be able to address those. On the ground, an American consultant is helping orchestras and museums revitalize their audiences. And he has this notion of creative voice. Every one of us has a creative voice. Every community can possibly find its own creative voice. What's the creative path? How do you become
suddenly engage with the arts and culture to a point that it has emotional significance to you, and eventually enough significance to you that you want to make this something that you commit to, that you are sharing with your peers, that you eventually participate in, and so on. Being exposed to diversity, being exposed over time, being socially reinforced, these are the kinds of concepts that he's speaking about in developing that human capital. How do we develop the human capital of individuals and of collective groups? This also resonates with François Perroux, a French economist, and he's saying culture actually creates the conditions for growth. Culture creates the development of people, the long-term education of people, the civic engagement of people, the awareness that they should have, and that in itself is the development that later will bring the kind of economic benefit that we're hoping to achieve, and certainly our politicians are hoping to achieve. So it connects a little bit with Alan Brown. The driver and enabler, that's UNESCO language. Driver is the driving economic value of things. The enabling factor is, be careful, when you're doing something, you're playing in people's minds. There's a cultural dimension in everything we do. Every investment, every project we do, when we design a lamppost, this lamppost has got a functional role, but it has a cultural resonance as well. The lamppost can be an object that refers to who we are by the choice of material, by the choice of design, by the message it sends to our citizens. We are paying attention in this city, and those decisions are paying attention to the human aspect of human. To give you an example of the enabling role of culture in Bangladesh, they went out with a program to educate women how to prevent diarrhea, which is a huge cause of infant disease and mortality. A saline, a bit of salt in water, was invented as a solution. 40,000 volunteers went around the country educating women. Only 8% of them would apply the treatment. 8%. What's wrong? What a, you know, simple solution, water, salt. Realize that in this society, men are the control of the house. They decide. They run the show. They went back, spoke to the men, 90% rate of success. They were not paying attention to the culture of the people, forcing it down on them. Farid Shahid, there's a notion in human rights called a cultural right, the right of each individual to access, participate, contribute. We have someone in Geneva who reports on abuses, will go to countries, see if women, Aboriginal groups, minority groups, youth are being fairly treated. Costa Rica has included, not Costa Rica, Ecuador has included cultural rights in its constitution. It has legal weight now. It will uphold before the courts, and you can challenge the constitution for not having the right to express your culture and participate in your cultural rights. But Farid Shahid says also it's the right not to participate. And that's a very challenging concept. If I'm a woman in a culture and my body and my integrity and my soul is at risk, I would have the right not to participate. And that speaks to some of these immigrants and some of the challenges that we're facing in trying to be honest about how far we're prepared to go with our view on democracy, participation, and the right and access to culture. And you'll see that yesterday I was presenting at the Institut Français. There are people that will refuse to take part in the culture, will remain isolated culturally. And we need to define the rules of living together, le vivre ensemble. That will pose a challenge to our very notion of civic and human rights. So Farid Shahid, cultural mediation I've already explained. International cultural diplomacy, something that brings me here today. But we have to look, and there's students, look, I have a former PhD student of mine looking at non-state actors, how we're projecting ourselves through social media and informally. And I venture to say the day that you will have sorted out your identity, you know, whether you're open or closed society to diversity, you will have to project that image to the world, to yourself, but to the world. And should you, like Canada, and now Germany, possibly, and France, and the United States, sort of say, we're open to diversity, we value diversity, we embrace diversity, you will attract diversity. When you think of Canada, if you close your eyes, you see diversity. We have 200 languages, 6 million immigrants, and we took very happily 25,000 refugees from Syria in 3 months. Mediation through co-creation, that goes to what was said earlier. We tend to think that, listen to me, I will listen to you, you watch, that's not enough. Prepare the meeting, debrief after the encounter, and co-create. Co-create. Why do we have social inclusion through work? Why do we have social inclusion through studies in school? Because we're together for the same objective, we're on the same focus. So co-creation is a way to actually invent something else and be together. The convention itself, it has 10 objectives, but this is a recent report, 10 years after it's been implemented. They've summarized it. They said, we need good governance of policy, and we need to achieve a better flow of cultural goods and of artists, sustainable development framework, and human rights and fundamental freedoms. And that's what I will be looking in terms of results. The governance of culture, fortunately, we are welcome. Civil society is in the convention. This is one of the very few international instruments that has a part of the text that says civil society is going to be a partner in crime. Very good reason. Diversity will let artists. You know, and so we are in UNESCO meetings, and I have to say one of the breakthroughs recently in December of last year was that finally we will be in the middle of the conversation, not sitting in the back of the room. We will be reporting on abuses, on achievements, on challenges that we see from our perspective as artists. That's a sick, you know, normally this is a convention between governments and countries. So we're just in the back and we're invited to comment at the end of the meeting. But we've changed the rules of these meetings, and going forward, we're going to be speaking and invited to report at every meeting. The Federation and other international and national NGOs. There's quite a lot of movement in this area to participate in the implementation of the convention. We're doing Indonesia. I mentioned that earlier, and I want to give that example. Indonesia was a dictatorship. It is now a civil government, and now the new president, Joko Widodo, a reformist, a modern man, a young man. I was there 2 weeks ago with some funding from the Swedish Development Agency, and for the first time ever, we sat in the same room, different ministries and civil society activists. This was the first time. It had never been done in Indonesia. That's governance. That's trying to define the future together and having a diversity of voices in the room. And LGBT was discussed. Is this something that we can speak of in a Muslim country where Lady Gaga was stopped, she was blocked from coming to Indonesia by the Muslim radicals of Indonesia? What are the rules of living together? What is the safe space for artists and for artistic expressions in Indonesia? Those are the discussions we were having just last week. Again, to give you a very practical example of this, they have broadcasters, they have a regulating agency that will define the rules of who owns, who operates, what kind of content, and that regulating agency was wise to suggest that it would not be permissible for broadcasters to portray gay and lesbians as normal people. It would not be acceptable. They would have to be presented as ill, as crooked, as deviants. It would not be acceptable for broadcasters to present them as normal colleagues, friends, neighbors today in Indonesia. And this was the kind of conversation that was made possible by this UNESCO convention through the support of the Swedish International Development Agency.
Other example, La Francophonie, the international organization based in Paris with membership in Africa, with membership in Eastern Europe and in France, Canada, and so on. They are now assisting the same in four African countries trying to involve civil society in defining the cultural policy. And to give you again an example. And that's a very strong symbol because it's a trade agreement. And it's a very strong symbol because now Europe is negotiating with the United States its own trade agreement. So for the United States that has not voted for the UNESCO Convention, now they have language in a trade agreement. They will not say it's not there. It is there. And there is language now in the Trans-Pacific Partnership that refers to culture as well and the cultural exemption. So a very clear example of how the convention is being implemented. Europe has cooperation agreement, and many countries have these cooperation agreements in the area of culture. But they've gone a step further. They said, we're not going to be just diplomatically, you know, exchanging theater performances and bringing artists and so on. They are offering special treatment to these countries. So for the Paris Forum, where you have, you know, the music is so important. Think of reggae or Jamaica. These are the countries of the Caribbean area. They want, obviously, to be visible and on the world scene and having their arts. So now Europe has agreed that mobility will be made easier and visas will be made easier for these artists to come work and perform in the EU. Special treatment for artists. In the case of South Korea, they have agreed they should have co-production agreement in the film sector. So a film that is made in Europe is considered a Korean film is considered a European film, they have access to funding, they have access to cinema screens, to TV quotas, so that's a preferential agreement in the audiovisual sector to create these co-productions. Indonesia, again, a very interesting example, has 99 cultural protocol since independence, but recently it's been about favorable treatment. Let's agree that it's going to be easier, you're going to move, I'm going to move, we're going to exchange on a preferential sort of arrangement. And this is something that many countries aren't aware that they can start asking from the more developed countries under the convention. I could be sitting in Cuba, or I could be sitting in Ecuador and trying to get from Canada, or from France, or from the EU, those kinds of preferential arrangements. It is a convention that they have signed. Artist mobility, again, very practical example, and Canada reports to UNESCO on this. They have created residencies and grants and scholarships and sometimes bilateral arrangements between the Arts Council of Mexico and the Arts Council of Quebec, the Arts Council of Canada, the Arts Council, and so on. So they have special arrangements to facilitate mobility of artists, but they also provide funding to Canadian organizations wanting to invite these foreign artists. They give them special treatment, again, for visa, not only to perform, but should they be on juries? Should they be even invited as guest speakers? And they give funding to foreign organizations wishing to invite Canadian artists to perform. That's as far as they're working to try and achieve this mobility and preferential treatment in the arts and the cultural sector. Sustainable development policies. I gave the example already. This is a first program of assistance that was paid for European taxpayers. Let's put it very simply. Money was offered to UNESCO for the convention to assist the developing country, cooperation. Remember, said cooperation. These are the countries that applied. This was a competition. You needed to file an application. There was a competitive process. And you could either be a country or you could be a city. Buenos Aires is a city. And here's the list of the projects that were selected. Experts were eventually sent to assist these cities and countries. And as you can see, there are a number of initiatives. Strengthening cultural industries. Creating in Buenos Aires, making Buenos Aires a hub, a center of production in the audiovisual sector for children's programs, not only for Argentina, but for the Latin American countries, including Spain, all the Spanish, you know,
country-speaking countries.
And so on and so forth. So Burkina Faso is probably the one that comes closer. The other one are pretty much on cultural industries and capacity building and policies and governance, things we've spoken about. But Burkina was clearly interested in developing the kind of experience with diversity through school for young and future adults. Some Canadian examples, and I'm coming to the end of my presentation. I will give you a range of examples that I think are relevant as we speak of sustainable development. Wapi Fani Mobile is the initiative of one woman, Manon Bakou. For 200 years, we've been struggling with our Aboriginal groups. Whenever we're brought to explain our human rights record in Geneva, every country says, yeah, but Canada has a poor record. These people are in poverty, their health condition is bad, the kids have no work, have no skills, and not only do they have problems with self-esteem, there's a high rate of suicide. When I left Canada last week, one of the communities of 200 people in the north of Manitoba was going through a spate. They had 5-6 suicides, one after the other. They were sending social workers, they were trying to understand what was going on. 18 in number were suiciding like crazy. That's the kind of challenges, social challenges, that Manon Bakou felt, well, maybe we can use the arts and culture to address. She goes 300 kilometers into the woods because they are living their traditional way of life. She will sit with the elders, with the chief of the village, and she will explain that she's trying to bring some room for them to learn the technique of producing a film, writing a story, putting music to it, and eventually sharing that story with the group and with the white man. And she's done this for a number of years. She has a mobile unit and volunteers going across to these various indigenous communities. And now they have been traveling the world. 100 awards have been received by these young people. And I can tell you, I've seen over the years the quality really sort of go up, both in musical expression, technical control, and these kids have now self-esteem, and the audience is full of white men. We have connected. That is, to me, sustainable development through arts and culture. And we could apply some of these indicators. Is there someone to take over when they stop? Is that having some outcome in terms of the cultural identity of these people? Are we spoiling them? Are we bringing our white society into their minds? We could look at these sort of outcomes, not just counting bodies, how many people were there, but what's happening when you left. Another example, so this was an NGO. This one is a school board in the large city of Montreal. We are 3.5 million people. That's half of the Canadian, of the Quebec province population, similar to Riga and to Tallinn. This is working with some of the most difficult neighborhoods, which happen to be also some of the most diverse ethnically and linguistically. And what they're doing is they're using these cultural mediators that I spoke about to bridge the needs in the classroom with the capacity of artists and artists' sort of facilities. They have partnership with 70 of those artists and arts facilities, and now they are offering money to transport the kids, to prepare for the outing, to assist the teacher, and so on. And just like with the Aboriginal groups, this was done not for culture, this was done to keep the kids at school, because there was a high rate of leaving school, of not attending school anymore. It was not socially, you know, valued. So the main reason for doing this is to keep them interested by bringing the arts and culture. And one of the outcome is that the kids are bringing their parents now to these social and cultural venues. Remember, outputs, bodies, outcomes. The parents are going to these cultural venues that they've never had a chance to see. They're doing this in the language and in the culture that they've never had a chance probably to experience through arts and culture. That's also positive social reinforcement. The Quebec Agenda 21 for Culture.
This is the province where I come from. And this is inspired by United Cities and Local Governments. If you're interested, there's a big international network of large cities and medium-sized cities. Very active on the cultural front. They believe that culture is a responsibility and should be provided by the city for social inclusion, for the kind of things we've been discussing. They have a roadmap called the Agenda 21. Let's envision and define the future through this agenda. The Quebec government said it's not just good for the cities, we want to do it also for the regional government. So they did a bottom-up consultation with all sectors of society, not just the artists. And now they said we have the roadmap and we have to engage and commit each sector of the government to play its part. Culture and the environment. If we're going to build a pipeline, what's going to happen for the local culture? Are we destroying the natural heritage? Is that going to impact the self-esteem and the value of the people themselves? And they have now a plan that engages 98 of the ministries and agencies to play and include culture and think of culture and sustainable development, including the health and social affairs in hospitals. And again, I can give you examples of hospitals that have creative spaces for sick children where they can play out their identity, some of those difficult moments they're going through, co-create and so on, exactly what we've been talking about. The same in prisons, the same in funding for research. Please, could social research also look at the cultural dimension of these social questions? And that's now mandatory, it's part of the mix. And the environment also has included that in their assessment of impact before they approve or recommend that the project should be undertaken. And finally, another national example, this one, but I think a relevant one. Mr. Trudeau, again, ladies, good looking. I think he's like a rock star, apparently. Mr. Trudeau said, I'm going to, yeah, I can see spots. Mr. Trudeau is promised he would double the budget for the Arts Council. And the numbers are staggering. I'm sure you're looking at this almost dizzy. So he's going to have, we're going to basically go from $180 million Canadian, that's like 130 million euros, to 230 million euros. This is massive investment in artistic expression, right? And Monsieur Paul, who's the new head of this Arts Council, is saying we need to reform how we do fund the arts. Because they used to have 148 programs for almost every form of expression. Painting, contemporary painting, classical painting, book writing, novel writing, history writing, children writing, and so on and so forth. It was divided by clientele. And was impossible to manage. This was like not, we know the arts and culture are no longer about clientele. It's all coming together, it's all multimedia. An artist wants to use all that is available as it's supposed to express itself. So they went from a clientele model to a social and sustainable model. They folded this into six programs, large programs, and they're now looking to see how it's going to impact all of the artists that were benefiting from the previous. One for the First Nations, affirmative action, to again keep the dialogue going with that sort of challenging part of our society. Explore and create. Should you be an artist and you want to say, I want to do something different this time, not the same painting I've done the last time, give me some time to maybe explore with material, explore with themes, and possibly create a new form of expression for myself. Well, now that will be positively received. Engage and sustain. Engage and sustain. Well, the connecting with the community, bringing diversity in programming, and bringing diversity in the workforce. That's what this new sort of objective is going to be. That's social engagement, social benefit through the arts funding. Artistic practice through collaboration, and we've touched on collaboration, across Canada and abroad. Now, how is that going to be implemented? Should be That is going to be fully deployed by next year, 2017. But one measure has already been announced. For organizations that are of 2 million grants, they receive, their large opera company, their dance companies, they receive 2 million or more. They will be evaluated, of course, on artistic quality, but the second criteria going forward will be reflecting community and engaging community. They will be judged on that. If they're playing the same old, with the same old audiences, they will not be as well appreciated. They need to make an effort to diversify audiences, to engage with audiences, to diversify programming. And they need to diversify a workforce, and they need to diversify in the decision-making, the governance on the board, in the programming department, the people that are deciding on these artistic decisions. And they were inspired by England, New Zealand, Australia, others. England has started this a year ago. They said the same, no same old, same old. This is taxpayers' money, this is arts for social benefits. And as a result, employment has gone up for black minorities in arts agencies in the UK. This is 1 year. I'm sure it's gonna go up as we speak. So very practical example. In terms of promoting human rights and fundamental freedoms, I spoke of the Swedish fund, which allows us to go to Indonesia. But the Swedish also are with the money putting human rights in the middle of a conversation that started with trade. Remember that we started 10 years ago with WTO. So they're coming back to fundamental questions. And they're challenging a lot of these states that have signed, Zimbabwe, China, you know, Algeria, all of these countries. What about your artists? What about freedom of expression? What about LGBT? What about, you know, youth expression and challenging expression? So it's very, very bold that they should be doing this.
I'm just going to go over quickly.
So this is something I've already mentioned, supporting good governance and participation,
inclusive.
This is the report, should it be interested, that presents 10-year of achievement. I've given you some examples, but this report covers a lot of these different objectives of the convention over the 10-year period, so we'll have more of Ecuador and Argentina and the sphere of cultural rights and so on. We have now almost 100 countries that will be presenting their report. What have we done with the convention? What are we going to do with the convention? So we're starting to have a serious body of knowledge around these issues, including statistics on, you know, the impact of these measures. And this is the table of content of that report, which shows that status of the artist is now a chapter with public service broadcasting, gender equality, digital technology, and so on and so forth. And I encourage you to read. There's some very strong intellectual contribution in gender balance, for instance, very strong contribution. Sustainable development by David Thorsby, very strong contribution to understanding these notions as well. So I think that's all very good.
How's my time?
5 minutes,
okay.
I just want to show you something. I'm going to go over this quickly, then we'll go back to the other PowerPoint a bit. This is to show you some of the funding that we provide for music in Canada. The system works this way. You're a broadcaster, you are given a license, basically you are a monopoly because only Canadian companies can operate these companies. You have a responsibility. One of the responsibilities is to put Canadian content, but also one of the responsibilities is to give a little bit of your profit to fund artists and the creation of more Canadian music. So we receive funding from the broadcasters, the radio and the TV. There's a pot of money. There's a pot of money for TV, there's a pot of money for cinema, there's a pot of money for music. The music pot of money is divided for the French province and the English language provinces. And it's administered by the industries and the NGOs. The government has given the money, they sign a contract, this is how you will operate and give and support the artists for musical creation. So the government is out of the business of deciding how the money is being spent. This shows you how in years 2012 and 2013, the money was allocated to what musical genres were supported. Alternative music, classical music, country music, contemporary, hip-hop, instrumental, youth, and so on and so forth. Diversity in musical genres. This is true diversity. Now let me go to what the English Canada Fund has been doing for diversity. I'm running out of space on one page to show you the diversity that they're supporting with the same money for the English language market. Folk, rock, alternative, popular, hip-hop, country, roots, electronica, jazz, blues, soul, R&B, punk, adult contemporary, the world, heavy metal, classical. And I need to go down the page because somewhere down there is Christian rock music supported by public money. And private money. So that is diversity in the making. Because this Canadian music that's being supported by these funds, of course, will be played by the same radios who have a quota to present Canadian music to Canadian audiences. Sustainable development. The beast will feed itself. Right? The beast will feed itself. So let's go to the other PowerPoint just to finish off quickly, and then I will take questions. I always like to share this one, even though this is not the subject of my presentation, but a couple of concepts again to read. John Hawkes apparently has been translated in Estonian, so if you can read Estonian, at least for you, otherwise it's in English. An Australian city councillor and administrator, John Hawkes, said culture, of course, is treated, you know, as a minor thing in government. Oh, it's the arts, and it's cute, and it's we spend on this. But I said, truly, we are cultural people. We're a cultural community. And if we are sitting down to imagine the future through policy, we bring into discussion the economic aspect. We bring in the social aspect. And now we bring in the environmental aspect. But why not recognize that we're cultural animals? Cultural beings, and put the cultural dimension in the conversation as well. Because truly we bring our values, our convictions, our identities in these conversations. And should we be recognizing that culture is therefore the fourth pillar of sustainable development, as we conceive collectively the future, let's try and recognize that we have diversity in culture in the conversation. And as we try and imagine the future, we're imagining the future for an even more diverse society, possibly than the one we have today. So let's try and bring as much diversity as we can in today's discussion on policy, so we can imagine a better future for the future diversity that we're likely to have. It speaks to democracy. Who's in the room and who participates in these discussions on policy? And now companies who have failed big time are saying we need diversity on the board. If we all think alike, if we all agree, we're likely to find failure. Germany has found failure when everyone started thinking alike. So think of diversity as a creative force and not just as a marginal thing to fund on the side. Every time you make a decision, a lamppost is an occasion to be human about the lamppost, about every decision that is going to be made, and impacts the cultural dimension of who we are, apart from the social dimension, the environmental consideration, and the economic consideration. The other one, which I think you probably know, is David Frosby, the Australian that I refer to, and that's very useful because there tends to be a mix-up. Culture is everything. You know, the chair is culture, and architecture is culture, and food is culture. Yes, everything is culture. But
saying to us is that we should consider that some of the artistic expression are at the beginning of the creative economy. When the Arts Council will have programs to fund the artists, it does not seek profitability. It does not seek immediate return. It does this for artistic needs, artistic expression, and possibly social needs and society needs. So we need to be able to protect that space and argue with politicians, no immediate returns, no economic benefits. When you write a book, you write a book because the industry will then use the book to publish it. That will become the creative industry. And then the cinema industry will make a film out of the book. And then possibly the game video people, as I explained earlier. So there are rings around this creative industry, but it's also to think that when we create a fund, when we create indicators, when we argue for the funding, we should be able to play with the arguments and not consider everything to be all one thing.
And finally,
well, this is Alan Brown. I spoke with Outcomes and Outputs. I was asked, how can we measure culture? Of course, the economic value of culture through statistics. But what about the social benefits? Can we prove that there is social progress and development? Are we making a better society for ourselves? Well, here's one example. I'm not saying this is perfect, but here's one example. In Canada, we have a central statistics agency, Statistics Canada, very serious in sampling, very serious in conducting surveys, ensuring, you know, validity of data, garbage in, garbage out. They conduct in-depth telephone survey. They actually do these surveys with 20,000 Canadians, but we've selected out the 20,000 a sample that is strong enough to make correlation in terms of statistics practices and social behaviors. 15 years and older, and they do these telephone surveys because obviously if it's only a questionnaire, people will say yes and no, and yes and no, maybe the question is not well understood, and garbage in, garbage out. So consistency and validity of data. In this interview, which was a long interview, they will ask, have you attended an art gallery at least once a year? Have you been to a theater performance at least once a year? In music, classical, festival, and book. And they're able to report. I just took one of the many artistic fields. They also, in the same survey, will ask people to self-report. Do you consider yourself to be in good health, in good mental health? Do you volunteer? Do you feel trapped in your daily routine? Is this a dark moment in your life? Stress level? Do you speak to your neighbors? Are you friendly to your neighbor? Would you do a favor to your neighbor? Are you overall satisfied with your life? Well, because we have those questions in the same survey, we're able to cross them, and we're able to break them down. And we're able to tell you that 44%, almost one Canadian in two of 15 years older, attended one theater performance at least in a year. That's a pretty good number. And they did fairly better than the average Canadians in 7 of the 8 questions that I was presenting earlier. They would be able to tell you that they feel in better health than average Canadians. They feel in better health mentally. They volunteer twice as much as the average Canadian. They are not feeling so trapped in a daily routine. Stress is equal. They know their neighbor, and they are doing favors to their neighbor more than regular average Canadians. And they have strong satisfaction with their lives, above average again. And you have this for each of these different sort of book reading and so on and so forth. So obviously this is strong positive outcome for society, and it speaks to why we're doing this. Now, I'm going to be honest, this is not a big debate in Canada. Hill Strategies, and I encourage you to go on the website, Hill Strategies, there's numerous survey of the value of social and indirect outputs of culture. In Canada, our big debate is the economic for the culture. Do we have to rewrite industries for the Canadian content, for the Canadian stories, for the Canadian people?
The social impact is not something that will get Parliament excited or politicians excited, but it's there. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your presentation. It's very interesting. My name is Andrita. I'm from the government organization Center for Equality Platform. And I am. So I have a question concerning this convention. And my question is if there is a place of mechanisms which I know that in other situations, for example, for the DAP, for Convention on Women's Rights, we have mechanisms when NGOs, other organizations, they can create shadow reports. Because even if Mr. Rolandas Bertauska said that they are very happy with writing reports on implementation of convention, but now, like person from NGO, I know that usually those who represent government, they try to show picture more bright.
Okay.
And those who represent the people from NGOs, they try to show real picture. So do you have this mechanism in place? Because being in Ukraine, I am a little bit suspicious if this diversity is really represented. Because, for example, if we talk about gender diversity, it is for sure underrepresented. That women are really, really underrepresented in all this cultural field, even if the field is recognized like more like feminine, soft area, not like politics or economy. So my question is,
it's a good question. Well, I don't want to be too close to this. There, what in the Priyara report, or I presented at a meeting, and that's a big change. Now civil society will be in the program of the meeting, not after the meeting. So that's basically allowing that civil society, and that's a diverse range of organizations and players, smaller and larger organizations, to come and share their appreciation of the implementation, what they have done, but some of the challenges that they've seen, and they'd like to question the audience with. So that's going to be very interesting because it brings basically, there a lot of the discussion in Paris has been about administration of the convention. Should we have rule for this? Should we have fund for that? Is the money being spent properly? It's a bit like a board of directors. They spend a lot of time on details. While we want to discuss content, policies, and how we impact the policies. So the first big change is to allow us to be in the middle of the conversation. Remains to be seen who will be there for the European-based groups, or can we invite people from other developing countries and use technology to help them contribute. So that's one, I think, one major element. The other element in the report, civil society is a partner, and the rules of how civil society should contribute are laid out. Parties or countries have to say how they have involved civil society in policy making. Is there a dialogue? Are there formal structures? Is this informal? So they have to be saying, not just for the convention itself, but more broadly, do you have a dialogue with these various groups? Please report on that. Second thing, as you've been engaging in civil society, assisting with the convention, are they mobilized? Are they raising awareness? Are they doing projects? Are they moving to assist with the convention? Not cultural policy, but with the convention specifically. And third, is civil society involved in preparing the report? Have you invited them to share their views on how you're reporting to UNESCO? And they have to say what they've done to include, have consultation, and eventually, in my country, Canada, I am given a page and a half of the report to write my report in the government report of Canada.
This is not like shadow report.
No, it's my report. I can write my report.
It's been discussed and it's been raised whether there should be shadow reports. And some countries have done shadow reports. South Africa has done shadow reports. We have been invited international NGOs to present sectoral report because country reports might not cover regional realities or international realities. Public broadcasting in Italy and France is very different, but there's a European broadcasting union that might want to say, what's the situation for broadcasting? So far, there is no mechanism for shadow reports. There is a mechanism for presenting in the report or contributing to the report. You can prepare your own shadow report if you're prepared to do it, and UNESCO will present it. But it's also the audience. What's the audience? What are you achieving with the shadow report? Because truly, you're trying to address domestic issues to an international audience that might not be able to understand really what's going on. You also have to think about that, because these reports are not discussed. We don't come like in Geneva to sit down and review the report of the country, understand these issues, how they progress. These are sharing information, sharing best practices, learning on the status of things. That's what it's meant for. So there will not be a question period. So, civil society reports has not been well done. Can we discuss these? And that's not how it's been.
I think we have a conflict about the Fijian situation because our national commission is responsible for coordination of this periodical report. I mean, in Fijian, Lietuvos nacionalinės komisijos yra atsakinga už šio bilioninės ataskaitos šio proceso organizavimą, tiesiog noriu pasakyti, dėl šių klausimų buvo dėl vyriausybinio organizacijų atstovavimo. Tai iš tiesų yra sukurta dar institucinė grupė ir toje institucinėje grupėje yra tikrai ne viena nevyriausybinė organizacija ir mes visą informaciją bandom pateikti tokį bendrą lauką, kas vyko per 4 pastaruosius metus tos kultūros laukė tiek nevyriausybinėme sektoriuje, taip tiek valstybinėme, bet aišku, periodinio ataskaitų vienas iš tikslų tos bendros informacijos tokio akumuliavimo, tai yra iš tikrųjų keitimas valstybių gerosios praktikos. Žinoma, kad taip pat tarp ataskaitų yra suteikiama erdvė įvardinti iššūkius, su kuriomis susiduria šalis ir tai, ką jos dar turi atlikti ateityje ir tas bus daroma ir yra daroma. Bet aišku, pagrindinis tikslas yra tos gerosios patirtys, ką mes galime ištransliuoti kitom šalim, kuo kaip galime jas įkvėpti ir kaip patys galime tą pasiimti iš kitų šalių. Tai čia tiesiog papildymas. Ir tiesa dar dėl buvo pasakyta dėl moteros, dėl normų kultūrų, tai aš nežinau, ar aš klystu, bet buvo tarsi toks tyrimas apie tai, kad tarsi moterų tik dėl lyčių lygybės kultūros sektorių.
Aš galėčiau trumpai pakomentuoti, kino srity yra analizuojama gana kompleksiškai moterų dalyvavimas kino mene. Nuo industrijos iki meninės dalies. Ir iš tiesų, jeigu į statistiką žiūrėti nepakanka, nes jeigu žiūrėsim į kino sektorių Lietuvoje, tai be jokios abejonės galbūt klausimas yra atvirkščias dėl visiškai blogos priežasties, nes tai, ką jūs sakėt, kinas yra suvokiama kaip kultūra, tai yra ta gyventoji teritorija, kuri be abejo dažniausiai mūsų pasaulio dalyje buvo galvojama turėtų užsiimti moteris. Tai iš kitos pusės kokią mes problemą turime, jeigu paskaičiuosime, kiek yra režisierių moterų filmuose. Vėl matom šiek tiek kitą situaciją. Ten jau yra teritorija, kuri ilgą laiką buvo užimama daugiau vyrų, beje pastaruoju metu labai smarkiai keičiasi. Tai šitie dalykai kartais statistiškai žiūrint, jie atrodo vienai, iš tikrųjų reikia žinoti ir tą, kodėl taip yra. Ir kai kurie net ir pozityvūs rodikliai, jie ne visą laiką interpretuoti labai pozityviai. Tai čia trumpas patikimas.
Actually, it was very happy to listen to sometimes give Lithuania as an example to the other countries. I'm really very curious what are the exact examples that you are using.
Well,
nothing specific comes to mind because I don't have the document in front of me, but the way that they're presenting their model, you know, the measures they've taken and the efforts they're making and they're trying to structure with the overall sort of vision that they seem to have for arts and culture. Again, to give you an example, maybe yesterday on immigrants, there was this discussion, and one of the first slides, I just did a bit of research on internet, and you should have seen the long list of policy measures, strategies, institutions trying to work and advance the rights and the expression and of minorities, including minorities with no territories. And I was amazed to find this, that you know, the Tatars and the Yiddish people and so on would have an institute to look after their needs. Well, of course, we can discuss whether it's been implemented properly, whether the results are good, whether everyone's happy, but at least there is some sensitivity. There's a very good sort of treasure trove to work from, you know, and I have the same feeling in the arts and culture. To give you another example, and when I'm trying to find indicators of, you know, we say outputs, but indicators of outcomes. Well, indicators of outcomes are these creative spaces, but we've heard this morning of the scars, of the physical signs of culture, because public art, of course, is a sign that this is important, and signage is assigned, and there's visibility around me, not just in the books. Well, I have to tell you that I've seen, in the day that I've been here, way more visibility of arts and culture in this city than I have seen in previous cities that I've visited this week. Spontaneously, out of nowhere, this is not dictated by any sort of bylaws that says we need this, otherwise we will not be a good city. Of course, the question will then be, is this only in the central part of town for tourist areas? Do we have that in other, you know, neighborhoods? But on the face of it, and again, where I come from, the commercial signage, just these posters on bus and metro and books, exhibits, radio stations, TV stations, film launches, about 70% of the weight of the commercial advertising is for arts and culture. We don't see it anymore. We're embedded in culture. So again, I don't mean to say you're perfect, but I mean to say you have pretty good foundation. I think it's just like the next step. I think it's just, you're just like pondering how could we sort of post-Soviet era define how we're going to operate, free market economy, European integration, identity minorities, and just unleash the potential. We're just looking to unleash the potential and possibly think that arts and culture are part of the key that would open that potential.
I was also thinking that the convention has such a wide scope. And you know, probably there are a lot of different stories all over the world. And I was thinking, would it be true to say that the challenges are quite the same?
No, they're not the same.
No.
No.
And since the stories?
Well, they are the same. When I refer to the slide that says, you know, globalization and social movements, they're the same, but the level of development is just so different from one country to the next. The historical, political history of each country is so different. Participation is so different and so on. It's very difficult to sort of say one size fits all or we're going to apply. That's why we learn from each other and we adapt these measures and these policies. A lot of people listen to what I say, this is great, but this is general participation. We don't have $180 billion for our Arts Council. Well, they have 5 grants for residencies for writers in Estonia, but at least they have 5 grants for 5-year residencies for writers. They recognize that literature is something that they want to contribute to developing. You know, so they have something to the measure that they're prepared to put effort on. But it's true that we have to be able to adapt. A lot of these countries don't even have cultural policies and cultural demand, because we haven't discussed a lot of that yet. But there's a lot of effort to develop the offer of culture. We're supporting artists, we're supporting industries, we have buildings, we have cinema, we have TV. But if we don't have audiences, we're in trouble. And if youth is on the internet, or does not come to the theater anymore, does not care about the art forms we're proposing, we're in trouble. What are the policies for the men? What are we doing to educate and raise awareness for the diversity of demand, not just the classical arts? And that's a question that we receive from a lot of our developing countries, friends, because there's no demand. Or if there's demand, it's pirated, it's piracy.
Or they consider this to be, you know, oh, the artist, poor guy, he's going to be, you know, sick, and it's not my fault. It's like, he decided to be an artist. What's his contribution to society? So they're seeking our advice on developing demand, and demand on politicians without good policies, and demand to fund properly culture. So you can see the kinds of challenges, but these demand questions are everyone's questions today.